Am I Paul Turner, work for HP, used to have a small or work for a small SI company called Technosis, where I know several people from, and I decided to give all that up and go and work for another small company, as the saying goes. Been on all the JDP's taps since Tahoe, so 1999 I was doing Platinum Exchange and saw this wonderful thing called SharePoint, that became SharePoint 2001, and thought that was great. My first project with SharePoint was a 30,000 internal portal for a bank. I have been working in the financial industry for quite a long time with people like ABM AMRO and RBS and all the ones that have gone bust, so nothing to do with me, honest. My last project was about a internet-facing site for a large Swiss supermarket and also for an airline, so we can talk about that as well. As we're getting into the business side, I have been tracking AIM, which is the independent records management, information management place, and I've been taking the records management and ECM, the content management exams, to broaden my appeal on that side. What I like is travelling, rugby union, sailing, whatever, powerboats, gliding. So if you like, want to talk to me, especially about the backstory, I need a few beers to get into the swing of things, because it did take take quite a bit of fixing to get the fizz from the component parts as we go through there. So, where are we? We're in the business journey. We're on session two. So, you are here. Not many more to go. And what we're looking at is, where are we and where do we want to be? So, very much as you sort of start in a project and you're not really sure what you want to do, what you're going to do with SharePoint. We assume the answer is SharePoint, but it probably might not be. So where are we? Bit of background into the backstory, but I just want to ask a question. How many people have started, got the CD from Microsoft and installed SharePoint without doing anything beforehand, any planning? Oh, come on, there must be some. Yes, there's one, two. Most of the organisations I go and see have done that and have got SharePoint all over the place, and it just keeps growing and growing and growing and uncontrolled, and you eventually end up with 10% of the useful information here, and the other 90% is there because somebody's put it there. One company had 15.5 copies of the SharePoint conference CD on their SharePoint because people were looking for it, couldn't find it, and said, oh, right, we'll be good citizens and put it onto the SharePoint. So we need to plan. We need to do something about it, because otherwise you just end up with the buzzwords like portal propagation and SharePoint sprawl. And the whole point of this is to make the system usable for the business at the right price, to get you the benefits that you need. Andrew talked about this before. When you get to a crossroads, which road do you take? So, we are coming down from here. Who wants to turn right? One person does. Who wants to turn left? This is not a trick question. Well, it is. It's just highlighting that if we don't know where we're going, if we don't have a map to say we need to turn right here, we could go anyway, and it doesn't really matter. So you need to think about where you're going to go with your SharePoint implementation. So we need a map. We need something to do. Going back to the backstory, I couldn't get my chicken to run around. There's more about chickens later, but this is a headless chicken, and we are sort of thinking, we've got all this stuff, we don't know what we're doing. Fizz oil has come together, from the three different companies, and we're still in our old silos. So we've still got Zenith, we've still got Zebra, or Zebra for our American colleagues, and we've got the FI, the FIO side of things. We have many, many old technologies. The Zenith people have got notes. No bandwidth solution, so because they had a lot of tankers, a lot of oil rigs, etc., they went down the notes route. And because of the licensing issues with notes and all the things that are happening inside of IBM, they're looking at what's the next upgrade for that particular version. So we might not have a business need to move forward. There might be some forced event, like a new version of Notes or a new version of SharePoint, or SharePoint 2003 is now not supported and you've got to go forward to maintain support. So we have many old technologies inside of Fizz. Notes is one, Documentum for the records management side, and I can't remember whatever else there is, but I think it's a typical setup of most organisations, that they have got lots of stuff, they paid for all the licences, and in order to get value out of that, they need to run forward or close down all those licences. The real problem, the real business critical problem that the company has got, is the misreporting of data, or the misreporting of oil field finds to the regulators. So if a Zenith person comes along and takes the readings from the oil rigs or the exploration rigs, they will come up with an answer 100 times bigger than if a Zebra or an FI oil company person came to it. So same information going in, but different information coming out. And that's because of the multiple versions of the documents that are in there. So we can't find the documents. Not really true. We can't find the right document. And Bill will go into findability in one of his sessions about how you set that up and how you set it all working. And what do we really want to do? The new CIO has come in. He has looked. He's taken about 3 months to settle down, find out everything that's going on, and has decreed that we're still in our old silos, we're not working together, we want to collaborate. We need to get a company ethos going together for the new Fizz organisation, and we need to break the old silos and hopefully not create new silos, but have a collaboration within the different brands. For all those who are... Yes, this works for the Americans as well. It's like BMW and Mini, same company, but if you go on their sites, the sites are totally different. But internally, when you're working with that particular company, they're just the same. They are all the one company. It's just the different sales brands that you go on. It's like HP and Compaq. Compaq is still a brand that we sell, but we're probably not doing that much anywhere. So what do we really want? So we've taken Fizz Oil, Fizz Energy. Yes, Fizz Energy has taken a step back. The CIO has come along and seen the many versions of the SharePoint portal that we got, the notes. I think we got Team Rooms in there as well. I think that was one that, after the second glass of Pinot, or Share Pinot as it goes, that came into the area. So there's lots of stuff that we're going to do. We're going to take a step back. We're going to plan what we really want out of this. How many of you actually plan your SharePoint implementation? Yes. That's good. How many of you lied about planning your SharePoint implementation? So there's a quote. Those who fail to plan, plan to fail. So if you don't do it, then you're going to end up in a bad place. you will have a system that's there, you will have a system that people collaborate on, but it's just like a glorified file share. And from the IT point of view, SharePoint is about three times more expensive as a file share than a file share is, because you're actually storing all the stuff on SQL databases and the storage area networks. So you can call in a business SharePoint consultancy, or you can look at the best practices. The Microsoft ones are very focused towards the technology itself. You probably need to take a step back about the business side, or you can attend a conference like this one. You can attend the business track, and then you get to know all about the bits and pieces around that. So Fizz Oil, Fizz Energy, I must stop calling it Fizz Oil, Fizz Energy brought in a consultancy firm, a business consultancy firm, and they ran a series of workshops with the business people and the IT people in the same room at the same time. No PowerPoints. Scary. I now should have a bowler hat on, because I'll be one of the consultants who ran these workshops. It was scary. Some of the IT guys hadn't even spoken to the CIO. The CTO didn't even know him. And most of the time, it was all about getting people working together. How many of you actually do have those sort of meetings with the business and the IT at the same time? So a fair few. But we could do better, because the whole point of the success of a SharePoint project is getting the business and the IT aligned, and everybody should be doing it, really. They came up with a methodology which is based on TOGAF, and we'll go through the explanation of the methodology. They were talking about bridges. So a bridge takes you from where we are to where do we want to be. Easy, isn't it? You just go from one side to the other side. We might have a bridge already. We've already got notes. We've already got SharePoint. We've got SharePoint 2003 in Zebra Consulting. And so there's already bridges there. So we could use those. We could use notes. We could do something else. But what we want is a brand spanking new bridge that meets our requirements, because we'll be just forcing this bridge to a use that it's not meant for, or hasn't been designed for. It hasn't got the capability to design for. So when you're building bridges, you need to think, what sort of bridge do you want? A couple of examples here. We have, does anybody know where this is? Fourth Road and Rail Bridge, yes. Does anybody know where this is? It hasn't been built yet, but it's the Hong Kong to China crossover bridge that converts left-hand drive to right-hand drive. So we are looking at particular requirements here, hence the shape of the bridge to merge all the cars from one side of the road to over. So particular design requirement, particular version to go through. I can't remember where this one is, but it's somewhere in the good old US of A, and it's basically rail bridge and road bridge merged together. And then this is the new Hong Kong bridge that has got trains, people, and cars all going together. Particularly labouring. We also talk about the Bailey Bridge. Bailey Bridge, quick build bridge, set parts. You take five edge pieces, one bottom piece, and you put it together and you span 6 foot or something like that, or 3 metres or whatever that works out in European money. And you just keep building and building and building. So there are various ways of doing this. When we compare it to SharePoint, it's, are we going to have separate bridges? In fact, we don't really need to say SharePoint, we could compare with other technologies as well. So because this is a SharePoint conference, we'll compare it with SharePoint. So separate bridges, do you want multi-farm implementations? Do you want a farm that does all the BI? Do you want a farm that does the social and whatever? Or do you want a single farm that does everything. The decision will obviously influence the amount of money that you pay for the licenses, the hardware, the storage area networks, etc., etc. So it's all about costs when we're going through. Does the existing bridge or the existing service work for you? If yes, then why are we bothering doing this project? And there are some times that no is a good answer. If you've got what you need, and instead of investing loads more, then if you can reuse it, then that might be an answer. But as most of my answers when I'm consulting and everybody else is in the business team is, it depends upon your requirements, then we need to go down into your requirements. So SharePoint farm workload, what does the bridge carry? What does it span? Is the bridge going over multiple hops? Is it like the one in Denmark where it goes underneath the sea and then comes out at the other side? Not quite a bridge, but it's a tunnel that gets you from one place to the other. So are we looking at centralised? And it all depends upon the requirements. So based on the TOGAF methodology, the problem and any problem in life can be split down into this sort of methodology. I'll just briefly explain it first before we go into it. Why are we doing this? The business view. Why are we here? Why are we doing this? Why do I need a new car? Is one. Why do I need a new house? Why do I need to build another house in my garden? So one of my colleagues might say, I need to keep my mistress in the house, in the spare house in the garden. My wife might disagree with that one. My wife wants my mother-in-law to go into that house. So there's different requirements around there. What the data or functional view, what is this thing going to do? I've got a small car, or I had a small car, and I tow a trailer. And we went up to the Lake District about 2 weeks ago. 4 inches of snow, 1 in 3 hills, and the poor old car didn't get up the hill, basically, because it had too much weight on the back. So why do I need a new car? Because the old car can't take the trailer up the hill. So what do I need it to do? Okay, so I need the car to tow a trailer of 2,000 kilogram weight. I need it to meet the 80% rule, which is the general rule about car to trailer ratio weights. And I need it to carry 4 people in comfort plus all the luggage. And then I need it to have a certain MPG of 30 miles per gallon, because that's the rules associated with our business rules about cars. So you put all those requirements into the thing, and you then come out with a list of about 10 cars that you can buy. And then you cut down into that and you come up with one or two, you test drive them, and then you go from there. So, talked about bridges, talked about cars. Now I'm going to talk about a bit about SharePoint. So, why, what, how? How is this solution going to be constructed? This is where we get into, are we going to do it ourselves? Are we going to bring independent consultants in? Are we going to put the parts of it in the cloud, parts of it on-premise? So those sort of decisions from there. And then with what? And no surprise, we eventually come up with the answer of SharePoint, but you're going to go through a list of, can we use our existing notes? The answer probably is yes, from a technical point of view. But from a business point of view, the cost of the license upgrade with notes is probably prohibited, but you need to do that that comparison. And the same with Documentum. Do you want to use that? And there's all all sorts of questions around that. The whole point of this methodology is that if you make a change up here, you will have to go down and re-look at the technical view, the implementation view. So if you put SharePoint in, unrestricted, nobody else, no restrictions to whatever anybody use, this is SharePoint 4, you will find that people use, if you release, as we have released it, Excel services. And then you suddenly get a load of reporting metrics being put onto your SharePoint server that you hadn't planned for, and therefore the service level agreement goes right down, the speed, the performance, etc. So one of these changes up here, do I want to deliver metrics to the business people, will mean that if we're still running on the old system, i.e. the car with a small engine, it won't pull the thing up the hill. So that's what we're looking at. That's what we're trying to get through with this methodology. And it's always coming back to, if we change any of the functions or want to add new, then we've got to review it. And I would like to suggest that if you don't do this, then you'll end up with like 80% of people with SharePoint with a sprawl, a thing that's just keeps, a monster that just keeps, a monster that just keeps eating money and needing IT support staff on there. So, with the business view, this is really for you highlighting, for you to take away afterwards. What are the internal and external drivers? So, are we looking at regulations from business, regulations from government agencies, regulations from all over the place? Are Microsoft withdrawing support from particular versions of their products? Are we trying to save money by consolidating all the software that we've got? I think HP, we used to have 1,426 different software products in our whole catalogue that we were paying licences for, and we've actually cut it down to about 200 now. So if you consider that, say, 500,000 for each of those, you can soon see that you're getting some change from that. The important thing that Andrew touched on is the business models and processes. Which are the mission-critical ones that we want to put into place? The one that we've selected, because we are having a load of problems and because Zenith got taken over by it, was they can't accurately forecast the amount of oil in their oil fields. So they exaggerate their oil finds, and therefore they come down. Their share price goes down, and FI Oil can take them over. So look at what you want to do with your particular SharePoint. Who participates in the business processes? I was working for a Canadian pension system, and on Wednesdays, the process that the pension went through went a different route because Nora was in the office. So Monday, Tuesday, Vera was in and she did it one way. Wednesday, Nora came in part-time, nearing retirement, and whatever she said went, and it went, the process went through a different way. So who participates in the business processes? Are the business processes accurate? Do we need to update them? Do we need to actually get them followed, the current ones that are actually there, so that you get the process going forward? And that brings us to what are the project goals, and probably more importantly, and Brad will go into this a bit more, how will the success of the solution be defined? Steve does a very good track in the information worker about user adoption, user acceptance of this. And sometimes you can measure the adoption by 20 people, or 20% of the people will use the system in the first 6 months, 90% in the after the year. But if you only measure people just going onto the system, then you can tick the box. But are they actually using it productively? Are they actually getting real value from the processes? So we need to look a bit more into a bit more detail about the solutions going to be measured. And this is where we step down into the next level, the functional view. What will the solution do? How it will be used? What services? Who is it going to be done to? And where is the data? You might find that the data is in different places. It might be in one part, in two parts, in three parts. And this is the problem Fizz has. We had the data or the spreadsheet in about five different areas, and they just kept using different ones as we go along. So these are just guides for yourself. The one with the bowler hat are the questions that you really need to be asking. Not exhaustive. There's lots more around here, but it gives you a start as to finding out what you really want to do with your solution. Getting a bit more into Sharon's, who is on next, as she goes from the functional to the technical view side in greater detail. I'm just setting the scene at the moment. We're looking at how should the solution work. So what application are we going to put in there? Which standards are going to apply? Do we need to go HTML 4, 5 for some of the internet facing side? And there's lots around there. And how will we achieve the capabilities? The implementation view, and this is where Microsoft are really comfortable, is what particular products and components of those products are you going to be used? How many different functions are there in SharePoint? Is it a one product, or is there six, or is there 10?
More than 10.
It is a huge piece of software. And this is one of the things that Andrew was talking about earlier. Mail, Exchange, all that Exchange does is mail. One function. SharePoint, when Microsoft sell it with the Wheel of Fortune, they split it down into six. Yeah, okay, everybody knows what it is, so that's fine. They split it down into six areas. Sites, composites, search, and whatever. So most SharePoint implementations, you shouldn't really install SharePoint and let everybody have everything at day one, because you end up with a mess. If you actually limit the features and functions that are available, then it'll be easy to implement. You will have control over that implementation, and you'll be able to actually meet your business requirements. So instead of trying to do, and I haven't got the slide, instead of trying to do that bottom right-hand corner, you do the particular ones in the top, the mission critical context version processes that you need to do. So how will the system be developed and deployed? So we're talking about cloud, talking about outsourcing, talking about on-premise. Are you going to do a combination of those? So one of my customers has got, and this is getting a bit old, that they've got BPOS as their cloud facing. They're soon to be upgraded to 365, or probably have. They've got a private cloud, and then they've got the on-premise. And we have spent years going through their thousands of applications deciding where it goes on that hierarchy. So they did a lot of work up front. I think it took about 6 months for them to go through what do we really want? Where do we want to be? And it's an ever-evolving journey. And once they've got one place going, then they go to the next stage. So we're not looking at just one thing to do. It's a continuous cycle. And I think that's what most people forget about SharePoint. And they think they are going to implement SharePoint, they're going to get the returns of investment after 2 years. And that is the way that most people look at ROI and SharePoint or any IT projects. So which doesn't really give you the grounding to go through this. But Bill and Brad will talk about this in much more detail as we go through. What is the source of funding? So, looking at the various stakeholders, not necessarily the people who are going to do all the work, because they will probably delegate anyway, but from the business point of view, you're looking at the solution acquirer, the analyst, the CEO, possibly the governance board. This is just a quick point at the particular people. It probably won't be right for your company, because you probably name the CEO and CTO as differently, the governance board, the business analyst. So it's just the sort of level that you're going to go. The functional view, the data view, solution users, who is actually going to do this? And then the technical side, we get more into the standard a standard Microsoft area, where you know the system developers, the solution developers, the subsystem suppliers, etc. So Sharon will go a bit more into detail of that. So that's where we are. Are there any questions that you want to ask at this moment in time? That's great. We can go on to where do we want to be. So with Fizz Oil, we've obviously split it down into the business view. What we want is we want to get the right information with the right results at the right time to the right person. So for those who are old enough, it's like the Martini principle, right place, right time, etc. Because at the moment we are not doing this. Fizz Oil, or Fizz Energy as it's now called, is still getting the estimation of oil fields wrong, and we want to do something about it. We want to have secure data within the regulations. We want to have the right people with the right access to it. At the moment, some of the people on the notes databases, because of the way it's being set up, is they can see everything. So they're the two main drivers, or the main business critical side in the context. We also want to bring in a new company identity. So Fizz, new company, new brand. We want to build on that brand. We want to make everybody proud of working for Fizz. And we want them to contribute to the vision statement of being one of the most innovative oil producing companies in the world. So bring in the old company forward and making it into the new vibrant Fizz company that we all want to work for. So some of the measures that we're putting in, and the big one is that we need to be cost neutral in 2 years. So that's our return of investment. That is something that the CIO has said, I'm quite happy to spend money, but I need to recoup that money from better practices, less staff, or quicker processes, or whatever, by being cost neutral in 2 years. We also have got the removal of file shares, because that is an aging infrastructure, and that's where a lot of the compliancy data is. So we want to get rid of that, and to be able to clean up the information that we've got in those file shares. For the one records manager in the room, this is where we've probably got, and this is very, very old technology, this is where we've probably got the smoking guns of data that shouldn't be in there. But we have no idea what's in there. As Andrew was saying about the 20 levels of file shares, then there's some important data in there. Most people do it. I think I've done it when I wanted to hide some information. So, but in nowadays, with compliance, you have got to be so open with the regulators that you can't hide anything. So we need to get rid of these file shares. The functional view. What should the solution do? We're going to bring social collaboration to all locations. The head office, the renewable research and department labs that are spread around the country or around Europe, and also to every single remote location. We want people to feel part of the same organisation. We also want to help with the uptake of the new company by bringing in three brands. A for marketing, so Fizz Renewables, good thing for an oil company to have renewables in their list of activities, wind farms, etc. So that is a marketing ploy, really, but it is also the area where there's a lot of money that's coming in from government to look at generating energy from renewable sources. Fizz Energy is the one that everybody sees the vans driving around, and Fizz Explore is the area for the people out who are exploring for all the oil fields. So we want to bring social collaboration, we want to bring everybody together, but we want to have these three brands, and we don't want them to become siloed again. So we've got a culture change going on here. And we're going to have a common projects. So bringing in sets of documents that are around for particular activities. So when we find an oil field, we will go ahead and use a defined set of documents that has been decreed the right ones by the CIO and all people, and then that makes our consistency of data going through, because we know which set of documents we're going to use. And if there's any changes, then that goes into that set of documents, and we can make any updates from there. So it's all about putting our table in order and making sure that we give the right information. There is nothing more in business that people don't like than unpredictability, which is probably a made-up word. But if you're not predictable and you don't give the right information, then your share price goes down. Because we are a multinational organisation, the websites, the social collaboration needs to be in different languages. That doesn't mean to say that every single document has to be translated from English into Japanese, into Arabian, into American, into whatever. It just means that when somebody comes onto the site, if they're working in Portugal, they'll get the Portuguese version, the skin, and the documents will still probably be in English. So that's it. From the technical view, we're looking at what are the service level agreements associated with this project? How often do we want it to be up? All the time, 24/7. What's the 3 nines, 4 nines availability of the system? How are we going to cope with the links to the oil rigs, where they only have satellites links, or the tankers? I have been working with some boats where they come up, stick the periscope up. Do we fire the nuclear missiles? No. Okay, we'll update our SharePoint and then disappear back under the sea. And if you're a British sub, you listen for Radio 4. If Radio 4 is still broadcasting, we don't fire missiles. That is common knowledge. I don't have to shoot you all now. So, what's the service level agreements? How often, how are we going to run this? What are we going to do with this system? And that also takes us into the area of how long is the information going to be on there? Not particularly a service level agreement, but there will be some data that needs to be there longer than the others. There'll be some projects that need to be longer than the others. Decommissioning of oil rigs needs to be there for about 50 years after the oil rig has been decommissioned. So there's sort of like long-term data that you need to keep. And most people think about putting data onto SharePoint. Not a lot of people think about taking data off it or how long it's got to stay in there. And if you and with the records management, if you're keeping information for 50, 100 years, SharePoint 2024 or whatever, if it's still around, it probably will be, will have gone through about 10 different steps and the hardware will have changed and everything will have changed. So, but your data has still got to be kept and still be available. So you've got to think about that. Other constraints. Particularly wanted to talk about what you are not doing. So we want to do the access Excel databases for the oil finds, but we don't want to do any of the metrics. We don't want to put in all the automatic reporting at this stage of the project. That might be the first step, might just to be sorting out the Excel spreadsheets. The next step will be putting it into Excel services, and then the third step will be getting a full metric reporting system out there. But until you've taken the first step, you can't really go to the end one. It's a journey. You've got to plan this. And those who fail to plan to fail. So if you don't plan it, you're not going to get anywhere, really. Implementation view. Talk a bit about this. Which software are we going to use? We have the choice of Notes, Documentum, SharePoint 2003, SharePoint 2007. This is in our fictional company in Fizz. They have bought so many companies, they've got everything available to them. And it is not unusual. There are plenty of companies out there who have loads of these choices about which software to use. Obviously, it's a bit like cars. Once they get to about 10, 15 years old and 200,000 miles, then you're thinking that they're getting near to the end of their design limits. But I think on my car I just sold, the ROI is really, really good. It's sort of like my cost of running it for a year over the X amount of years I have, it has been about £1,000, and that's all, including depreciation, etc. So that's the point. That's a good ROI of keeping something a long time. So you need to think about that. So what software is Fizz going to use? Are we going to think about the cloud? Some of the data that we're looking at, we don't really want in the cloud. We might have security implications of putting it into the cloud. But it's something that you've got to think about. It's something that you've got to do there. You've got to do and consider it. And it may be that we don't do the cloud today. It may be that we do a bit of cloud in the future. Maybe that we do the extranet version in the future. So we're looking at not doing the cloud.
I would posit that question, your question, what software do you use? The most common answer to that is all of them. But it really depends on which division you're talking about, which application you're attempting to have, implement, which portion of your problems you're trying to solve. Paul was saying, the people talk about the inertia that has to be overcome from old systems migrating up. The reason that there's inertia there is because the value has been established. You know how much it costs. You know what kind of benefit you're getting out of it. It's hard to move away from a system that's generating savings. And so, in most cases, in almost all cases, I would mention, you're going to end up having multiple instances. It really is a question of what part of your enterprise you're actually talking about.
Heterogeneous environment, definitely. So you touched upon my car. My car was happy. I was quite happy with it. And
from point A to point B, doesn't have to be a Ferrari.
It doesn't, no. And it did everything I needed it to until a different set of circumstances came along, and then we realised the limitations. And that might happen with your implementation of SharePoint as well. No, I'm not going to say anything.
You don't have Windows here. It's what Americans would call shit box.
I used to have one of those. Not anymore. So, we're looking at... I don't think our graphic artist can write that word down on the thing.
He was just about to.
Yeah. A brown pen, yes. So, what Brad has said is true. You probably find that you do use heterogeneous, many different versions of the software, and there will be stepping stones going forward. And what we're looking at is, since this is a SharePoint conference, the answer might be SharePoint. So what we're looking at is, because we know of some of the limitations with SharePoint over remote and non-existent links, we are probably going to have to look at a third-party vendor for that replication down to the oil rigs, etc. Because of our requirements, we're probably going to go for SharePoint Standard Edition. Possibly.
In fact, I'm going to go through the decision-making process around that in session 13.
Okay.
Specifically around edition selection and multiple different versions of SharePoint running in the same enterprise.
Yeah. So.
Come to session 13. That's on Thursday.
I know a good joke, Bill. So, we have a plan. We know what we're doing. We have spent loads of dollars on this consultancy who have came up with this methodology that says, think about what you're doing, have your map, where are you going to go, etc., etc. So that's great. We also need to know what we've got in our existing systems. And this feeds into the session about compliancy and findability, everything else later on. So we have been sold by these consultants an information optimization service where they go and crawl through search or whatever they do. I don't know what it is. I'm a business person. Then they'll just come back with, you have got 25 duplicated items here, and they come back with a pretty map saying where everything is. So we're going to go for one of those, because we are going to buy in that expertise because we don't have it internally. So one of the decisions that you've got to make is, do you need these external consultants? And from my point of view, from all the speakers' point of view. Not forever.
No, absolutely. Anytime a consultant says that he needs to be there the whole time, he's lying. And as a consultant, I'm telling you that. So consultants are outside consultants are critical and important, but not sustained. So.
Well, what he's saying is, if a consultant tells you that, if it's not you.
I'm saying that, but I'm telling the truth, that you absolutely need to keep paying me for as long as
Yes, I think it was Brad who was saying, I am presenting the best practice. This is my best practice. And somebody asked him, why is it the best practice? And he says, because it's mine. And it's true, because he's still up on the stage, then he has the kudos to say that. So we're going to buy some third-party stuff, third-party consultants in to do this service, because we don't know what we're doing. Critical is the communication plan. We're going to set up a program for doing this, for keeping everybody informed. And most of the SharePoint projects that I have seen failed is because nobody knows that they're actually doing it. So the users don't know what's happening. They'll get trained on a Friday, come to work the next morning, and they don't know why they're doing it. So you need to set up a communication plan. You need to have Badges, prizes, time, clocks. Yes. Thank you, Brad. Yeah, you need to have badges. You need to have some sort of socialising, getting together for the people who are going to use this system. One company I was working for did a film theme, and they gave tickets to premieres of new films that were coming out for the best suggestions, the most usage of a particular part of the functionality, or the most number of blogs they did. They then changed the rules because everybody was blogging about, I had sardines and toast for breakfast or whatever. So you've got to make it relevant. You've got to change it as you go along. We are going to target critical, simple processes. This is Fizz talking. And it is always easier to target one process. In my consultancy area, I will go in and target maximum of two processes, get those working in a set period of time, say 2 months or whatever, and then you can build on that going forward. So we're looking at the
low-hanging fruit.
I didn't want to use that term, Brad, but yeah, it's low-hanging fruit. And once you get that in place, then everybody, because of your communication plan, hears about it and they want to be part of it. So you're building success on success. So we're going to set up, underneath the program, this communication plan. We're going to have the branding infrastructure, etc. And now, I am not a headless chicken. I am a nice, calm chicken with a head back on, just relaxing and enjoying the countryside as we go along. So, that's it. We have a program, we have a communication plan. We can sit back and relax, can't we? It will get done. And I think that's me.
I think at this point, it's delegation.
It is all delegation, yes. So, any questions?